Hello, God bless you. Welcome to the House of His Glory. I am Pastor Deidre Campbell Jones. Welcome to our third Sunday message on June 20th, 2021. Welcome, fathers, and happy Father's Day to you. If you are joining us live at thehouseofhisglory.com/live, please say hello in the window this direction. Let us say hello to you. Chat with us during the service. If you are watching from on demand at thehouseofhisglory.com, which is the main website, or you're watching from the app, which you can download at any app store under iChurch for Life. However you are joining us, whenever you are joining us, if it is not Father's Day when you are here with us, we're just so glad you're here whenever it is. I'm excited for today's message. So get settled in, get comfortable, and right after this brief introduction, we'll get our message started, our service started for today. I'll be right back.
And now it's air in our chest, that's why we're singing it back to you. For every battle you've won, for everything that you've done, and everything that you're gonna do.
Seen too much to ever doubt it. Feel so good, I wanna shout it. Yeah, when I really think about it, all I wanna do, all I wanna do is
for joining me for today's message. As I said, happy Father's Day. Mom, I apologize again because I remembered to say happy Father's Day to all the fathers who are joining us. To my husband, I love you. Happy Father's Day. And I apologize again for missing to mention that on the Sunday for Mother's Day. But Mommy, I know you know that I love you too, dearly, right? So thank you everyone for joining us. We have another message in our sermon series, Going Into the World with God. But before we get into it, let's just go before our Heavenly Father in prayer and thank Him for this time together. Father, thank you for being the best example of a father any one of us could have. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for being a good, good Father. And for those of us who may have had wonderful fathers on earth, for those of us who have had not so wonderful fathers, for those who did not even know their fathers, thank you for being our Father. For those who are good fathers themselves, thank you for being an example to them. For those who have never had a father of their own, thank you for being an example of what it means to be a loving, caring, compassionate, strong, nurturing, wonderful father. And so, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this message. I thank you for everyone who is here, no matter when, no matter where, no matter how, in order to receive this message that you have for us all today. Father, let this be the message that truly brings the light of Christ into our lives. Let this be the message that brings us a revelation of our purpose in the kingdom of God. Let this be a message that draws us into a deeper, more exciting, mutually communicative, wonderful relationship with you. Let this be the message that empowers us and gifts us and enables us with the Holy Ghost. Let this be the message that draws all those who do not know you as their own Lord and Savior to say, yes, Jesus is Lord, to confess with their mouths that they believe that you raised him from the dead, and to ask you to forgive them of their sins and to make them your own. Father, heal our bodies through this message. Father, give us peace in our minds and in our spirits through this message. Give us clarity through this message. Father, give us a reason to want to walk in the ways of the kingdom of God in every aspect of our lives through this message. And most of all, Father, just bless us and help us to know that you are with us, that this message is for us. Help us to lay aside every weight, burden, and distraction so that we can receive exactly what your heart has for us through this word today. We give you all praise and glory for it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen, beloveds. Let's go into this song of praise. It's a good one. And we will come right back with our word for today. God bless you.
hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call.
Joining me for today's message. As I said, it is the third message in our sermon series, Going into the World with God. It is also the last and fifth series in our Kingdom Life Values. And today we are talking about the Word of the World. We've been talking all month about different aspects of the world. I've been defining and describing just exactly what the world means scripturally. And so before we can learn how to go into it, we needed to know what it is. We needed to understand the ways of the world. And today, what I want to talk about is how our speech reflects what we believe. And okay, what that has to do with the world is that just like we can't go into the world if we don't know what the world is, well, we can't go into the world if we act and sound the same as the world. Because when I finally get into defining what it means to go in the world and how we go in the world, we need to have all of these particulars situated. Because truthfully, you know, God wants us to be an example in the world. Like I said last week, He wants us to be a witness of the world. A witness of Jesus in the world. But we can't do that. We can't be an example and witness of Jesus if we sound like the world. We have to sound like Jesus. We have to sound like what the Word of God says and not what the world says. And so that's what we're talking about today. All the aspects of how our speech reflects either the kingdoms of this world or the kingdom of God. Heart of the world. Romans chapter 10, verse 10. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. We talked about this verse in the Sunday message that was Youth Sunday's message, what, 2 Sundays ago, I believe? Not 2 Sundays ago. At the end of at the end of May, in the 5th Sunday in May. All right, so this was one of our verses for that message. And we talked about, or this verse talks about, how belief is associated with the heart. How what we believe is associated with our heart. But scripture also says, out of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of the heart, the mouth speaks. That's in Luke chapter 6 and verse 45. And so what we speak directly reflects what we believe. If what we believe is associated with our hearts, and what we speak comes out of our hearts, then therefore what we believe is directly linked to what we speak and what we say. But the proof of what we believe then shows up when we get a doctor's report, when we have a health scare, when we get an unexpected bill that we can't pay for, when we get bad news, or even when we get into a funky situation at work or with a coworker or with a friend. What we believe will show up in how we respond. What we believe will be reflected in those first few words that come out of our mouths, you know, when we're not thinking, when we're just reacting, when we give that initial response, generally that is going to reveal what is stored up and laid up in our hearts. And truthfully, what we speak is going to determine how God is going to move in those circumstances. When we get that doctor's report, when we get that unexpected bill, when we get that bad news, or when we're having a difficult time in our relationships, those are the times to choose your words carefully, so that faith in what you believe can be enacted upon those circumstances. That is when we have a heart towards the kingdom of God and not necessarily a heart of the world. We'll see a proof of that in the words that we say. If our words reflect what the world says, if our words reflect what the doctor says, if our words reflect what the teacher says, or what our coworker says, if our words reflect what the news says, what the media says, we will be aligning our hearts with the ways of the world. Now, look, facts are facts, right? A doctor's report, a diagnosis is based on the facts. They found this, your blood told them this, your blood pressure told them that, you know, the pain in your body, being rushed to the hospital, whatever it is, those are the facts of your circumstance. Your bank account being less than the bill that comes due is the facts of your circumstances. So I'm not talking about lying or dismissing or rejecting, or did I say denying, or being naive about your circumstances and speaking in a way in which you are in denial about your circumstances. I am talking about having the Word of God, the truth of God, that you believe is more powerful than your circumstances. Speak over those circumstances and speak the Word of God into those circumstances. See, if you believe that God's Word is true and that His Word is true for you, then it's going to be true regardless of what facts the doctor finds, regardless of what your bank account says, regardless of how you've been betrayed, how you've been spoken to, or what you've been accused of. If there is a truth in Scripture that contradicts that diagnosis or that word against you or that attack or persecution against you, then that word of Scripture that is diametrically opposed to your circumstance is the very word in which you can use to change that circumstance. You can speak the truth of the word to speak change over the facts of this world. In your own world, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now look, I am not just preaching and teaching some bizarre thing. You know, I'm not trying to force you into some supernatural, mystical, impossible way of being. I am speaking to you of the Word of God, whether it's been your experience or not, whether it's ever been your belief or not, whether you currently feel like, well, but this or well, but that. That's all well and good. It's a matter of what you believe, like we just said. That's what's in your heart. But what I am speaking about is exactly what the Word of God says. If your belief about healing, divine health, about biblical prosperity, about abundance, about salvation, about your protection, if those beliefs are less than or come against the knowledge of God, then that is a thought that must be brought into captivity and into the obedience of Christ. What does that mean? That doesn't necessarily mean like we would automatically assume that you are being disobedient, that you are disobedient to the Word, and that you are being disobedient to Jesus Christ. What that means is that you need to take that thought and put it in handcuffs and make that thought obedient to the work of Jesus Christ on the cross and to the Word of Christ in these scriptures, so that in a very practical aspect, if I am having pain in my body and I think this pain is never going to go away, that is a thought that is directly against the knowledge of God, God who is a healer, God who has promised that by the stripes of Jesus, I was healed, God who promises that He will, that Jesus took on my pain and my iniquity, that I have to take that thought and bind it and bring it into captivity, put handcuffs on it and lock it into the prison of the truth of the Word of God. But you see, we have this way of being in our own world, right? And that then this very verse that says casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, well, what does that have to do with the world? It's because our thoughts most frequently, usually, generally, most frequently, follow what the world says. And what the world says is generally going to be influenced or even created by the enemy himself. In fact, the enemy gets in your thoughts. Our thoughts and our imaginations are his playground. He has access to our feelings so that we'll have a tendency to say out loud, "Well, I just feel like." And we'll trust our feelings more than the Word of God. "Well, I just feel like it's this way." Or, "I just feel like this is the truth." Or, "I just feel like this is what I should do." And the enemy has access to our feelings because the enemy has access to our souls, our minds, which are our thoughts, our will, which is our desires, and our emotions, which are our feelings. And our soul is what eats of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Our soul is where we make up for our own mind what's good and what's evil. Do good, get good. Do bad, get bad. And our soul is where we interact with the ways of the world based on our five senses. And so the enemy gets into our thoughts. The enemy influences our desires. And the enemy controls our emotions if we do not keep them in captivity and cast them down and keep them from exalting above the knowledge of God. And so the enemy gets to us through TV, through media, and access to the world to get us to think like the world. And if we think it and we begin to believe it and then say it, it will come to pass. Regardless of whether it's the ways of the world or the ways of the Word, if we think it and then believe it, we'll believe it and then say it, and whatever we say will come to pass. That's what it says in Mark 11 and 23 and 24. But Luke, let me go to see if I can get there quickly. Luke chapter 2 and verse 23, one page over here, it says, "As it is written in the law of the Lord," 2 and 23, that is the wrong verse, 35, so close, "Yea, a sword shall pierce through my own soul, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed." All right? The Word of God has a way of revealing the hearts of mankind. That Word of God, that sword, the Word of God is a sword that pierces asunder to the very heart and marrow of our souls. The Word of God can pierce through the soul. It can pierce through so that the hearts of man can be revealed. Scripture says that the Word of God is like a two-edged sword that is able to pierce asunder, to divide asunder the very hearts and intents of man. That it can rightly divide the word of truth. So that if you are believing the truth of the word, that word will be revealed through what you speak. And what you speak is going to be reflected in what you believe, and what you believe is reflected by what you're thinking. And whether or not you're casting some of those thoughts and imaginations down, whether or not you're allowing the truth of the Word of God to be exalted above those thoughts. And I mean, you know, that takes practice. That takes practice. I try to practice. It's not about just being positive. It's not about just not speaking negatively. It's about specifically and accurately speaking and consistently speaking the Word of God. We have a tendency to be in our own world and in our own thoughts, and we get so consumed by our own thoughts that oftentimes we can believe that just because we think it, that it is so. But we really, truly need to take those thoughts, especially if you know, things aren't working out for you, if you are struggling in your finances, or you're struggling in your relationships, or you're struggling with your purpose in life, or struggling on your job, it's time to take those situations and analyze, what am I thinking about it? You know, if you're having problems with your friends, if you're having problems in the same areas of your life all the time, if you're hearing people saying the same things about your character or your personality all the time, it's time to take those things and bring them up before God. Search them up in the scriptures and find out, how am I thinking about this? And where do I need to cast some stuff, cast some thoughts out of my mind and my thoughts, my will and my emotions, and truly claim a new perspective, a new way of thinking, so that you can begin a new way of believing and a new way of speaking. Stake your claim in the world. Mark chapter 13, verse 11. But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what you shall speak, neither do you premeditate, but whatsoever shall be given you in that hour, that speak ye. For it is not you that speak, but the Holy Ghost. Now, I teach this verse when I'm coaching, and I tell people, you know, when you're in that situation, when you know you're going to be called into the boss, when you know that your significant other has got, you know, something that they want to talk to you about, when you know you've got to go into that difficult conversation, or you're about to have a difficult confrontation with someone, you pray a prayer quickly based upon this verse. Holy Ghost, give me the right words to say. It doesn't have to be long. It doesn't have to be memorized. It just has to be, I trust, Holy Ghost, that as I'm asking you to give me the words to say, that I promise that I don't worry about what to say. I don't premeditate and determine what to say. I will trust you that when the time comes, that what I say is what you've put on my heart to say. All right? But I also want to teach this verse with Matthew chapter 6 and 31 that says, take no thought. In that verse, it's referring to take no thought to what you will eat and what you will drink and what you will wear. But if we take Mark 13 and 11, right, that says do not worry about what you say, and we add that to Matthew 6 and 31 that says take no thought, and we add that to 2 Corinthians 10 and 5 that says take every thought into captivity, that's how we are really managing what we're thinking about and what we're believing. And I specifically mean, that means don't take those thoughts that the enemy is putting into your mind. Don't claim those thoughts that you are thinking all the time. Don't claim, don't make phrases that claim what the enemy is doing in your life. Don't claim the diabetes. Don't claim the lupus. Don't claim those bad situations by saying, my diabetes, my lupus, overdrawn account. I don't know. I'm trying to think of something financially. We claim situations in our lives. We claim attacks of the enemy. We claim the ways in which he's stealing from us, killing us, killing off things in our lives and destroying things in our lives by attaching words of ownership on them. And so, hey, if you claim that disease, that sickness, well, then it's yours. And if you've already claimed it, how can you get rid of it? How can you claim your healing and claim the disease at the same time? And so that even if the diagnosis is true, right? I have been diagnosed with cancer is a whole different sentence than my cancer. My cancer keeps it, it keeps it close to you. But a diagnosis can be reversed, right? You can not hold on to that diagnosis. You don't make it your own. And there's things about our lives that we stake a claim to. We go, oh, well, I'm not this. I'm not smart in this. I can't do math. We stake a claim to what we can and what we can't do, what we think we can and can't have. You know, I'll never be able to buy a house. Well, that's true because you've just stated it. But if you say, you know what? My finances aren't allowing me to buy a house yet, but God willing, I'll be able to have a house in the next year. That's a whole different statement, right? But it's one that still reflects the facts, but still claims the truth. That's where you've got to stake your claim in this world, by staking your claim according to the promises of the Word. God promises you habitations with goodly stuff. I love it when the Bible uses the word stuff. God promises you abundance. God promises you healing. God promises that your children will be taught of the Lord and that they will not stray away unto strange beliefs and be taken unto captivity. That means unto bondage, unto things that are idols and things that pull them away from God, or even pull you away from even being able to enjoy them. That is exactly what Deuteronomy 28 says. And so if you have been promised anything in the Word of God, you can stake your claim to it, but you stake your claim to it by your words, in the same manner in which you have the choice to stake your claim to whatever the enemy is doing. The choice is yours. What will you claim? Scripture says you can choose life or death. You can choose blessings or cursings. The choice is yours. It's a matter of what you speak, because it says then the power of death and life is in your tongue. So what you choose is in the power of your tongue. What you choose is in the power of what you say. And God gives you a hint. Choose life. So if cancer is going to kill you, or if diabetes is going to kill you, or if heart disease is going to kill you, don't come. claim what's going to kill you. Claim life. Claim the Zoe life, the everlasting life, the eternal life, the abundant life, the prosperous life, the everlasting, successful, abundant life that God has promised you. And He's promised you healing. He's promised you health and well-being. He's promised you peace of mind. He's promised you abundance. He's promised you not just what you need, but what you want. Woo! That shakes stuff up a bit, because I've said this before. Sometimes we speak the ways of the world, right? We speak what we believe, what the world says, and it's not accurate to what Scripture says. And so that's one of those phrases that says, God doesn't promise to give you what you want. He only promises to give you what you need. And that is just not so. Because even, that's the communion bowl. Even Mark 11 and 23 says, whatsoever you, or that's 24, whatsoever you desire when you pray, believe that you've received it and you shall have whatsoever you say. That's why we're talking about the word of the world. Are you going to believe the word of the world that says that God won't give you what you need, what you want, only what you need? Or are you going to believe the word of God that says, thou shalt not want, that you shall not want for any goodly thing? What does that mean? It means that you shall not be left wanting. Why won't you be wanting? Because He'll give you what you want. You won't have a need to want for anything, because God will give you what you want. Scripture says that when you delight in Him, He shall give you the desires of your heart. Now, if the desires of your heart are a goodly thing that is promised in the Word of God, then it's yours. It's already yours, because Scripture also says that all the promises of God in Him are yea, and in Him, amen. So when you speak amen to the promises of God that He's given unto you, that's when you stake your claim, not on the ways of the world, but you stake your claim on the promises in the Word. Amen. The best of both worlds. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your seed may live. Now, I just referred to this verse, right? But the reason I want to bring this up again is because before I was talking about your words have the power of life or death, blessings or cursing, right? That in the power of the tongue is death or life. But now I want to bring it up because it's a matter of choosing. You have to choose. You cannot have both. This is not a Deion Sanders kind of word. You cannot have both. God doesn't like it when you mix the ways of the world and the ways of the kingdom. I know in my heart that He doesn't like it, but He doesn't like it not because, oh, it's displeasing to Him, but it's because you're not walking in the fullness of His faith. You can't say, oh, well, you know, I believe that God is a protector, but, you know, no, you're going to believe or you're not going to believe. And I've used this analogy before. I probably haven't used it in a long time, but it's like a cart. And what you believe is in that cart, and you want to pull that cart towards you. The problem is, on one side of the cart is and facing you is a horse called faith. But on the other side of the cart, facing away from you, is a horse called doubt. Both horses are attached to that cart. And so if you have nothing but faith that what you want is going to come towards you, then it's going to come towards you. But if you have a little bit of doubt, it doesn't matter. Faith, it's equal horsepower. It's equal horsepower. You've got the horses pulling in opposite directions, and that cart is not going anywhere. But if you have little faith, no faith, you're not using the faith that God has given you. You're not using the horse that's been attached to your cart. You disconnect that horse, and doubt runs rampant. Then what you want is not coming towards you at all. And so you cannot have the best of both worlds in this situation, in the scriptures. You cannot have your cake and eat it too. And in fact, there are many scriptures that tell us that we cannot have it both ways. John 24 and 15 says, choose you this day whom you will serve. Are you going to serve the ways of the world, or are you going to serve and choose the ways of the word? Scripture also says to choose God or choose mammon, but you cannot have both. You cannot choose the spirit of God and serve the spirit of mammon. You have to choose one or the other. And I guarantee you, if you choose God, if you choose life, if you choose righteously, if you choose according to the word of God, you will have the best of this world. You will have the best of the kingdoms of this world, because the best, God's best for you and for me, is according to his word. Plain and simple. You will never get God's best by pursuing it through the ways of the world. Make your way in this world. Job chapter 22, verse 28. You shall also decree a thing, and it shall be established unto you, and the light shall shine upon your ways. Now, I also brought up this verse not too long ago. And so when you know that you know that you know what you have been given in the Word of God, when you know that you know that you know that God's promises are true and they're true for you, and when you know what it is that you actually have been promised, and that whatever it is that God has been promised is yours and already been given to you, then it's not about you asking, begging, trying, pleading. It's not about you living right in order to be made worthy of God answering your prayers. It's not about moving God's hand. It's not a matter of praying the right combination of words that God is moved with compassion to answer them. No, it's a matter of claiming what's yours, and you do so by making that decree, by making that declaration. A decree or a declaration is definitive. There's no doubt mingled with or mixed with a decree or a declaration. You don't hem and haw over a decree or a declaration. It's a statement of being. It's a statement of fact. It's a statement of faith. There is nothing but faith in a decree and a declaration. And it's through making that declaration that it will be established unto you. Like I mentioned before, in Mark 11 and 23 and 24, you've got to, well, I mentioned in 24, but what I didn't mention in 23 is that when Jesus says, you've got to say to this mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea. You make a decree and you make a declaration. I decree you be removed, and I declare you be cast into the sea. You tell it what to do, you tell it how to do it, and you do it with belief that when you believe that what you say will come to pass, then whatsoever you say will come to pass. Job 22 and 28 says that it shall be established unto you. I'm telling you, this is still the kind of faith that I am striving to walk boldly in. Boldly in. To say, God has promised me this, and so therefore, I decree it. I declare it. I decide it, and I state it. In the name of Jesus Christ, let it be. Let it be this way and that way, and amen and amen. God said it, so why can't we do it? Why is it so difficult? Because the enemy gets into our thoughts. The enemy affects our beliefs. The enemy gets into our emotions. We are bound to our five senses that says, if I see it, then I believe it. We have so much bombarding what we hear that it's hard to hear the voice of God. We have so much that we see that negates what we've heard, that it's hard to hang on to that word. It's like a trying to catch a butterfly with butter on your hands. I don't know. It's like we have so much of a struggle to hang on to the truth, when the truth is actually a rock, a solid rock of our foundation. It should be the rock of everything we believe, of everything we think, of everything we say, and everything we do. Choose ye this day to believe the promises of the Word. Choose to state those promises by faith. Choose to make your own way in this world. Joshua 1 and 8 says that when you meditate on the word day and night, that's how you're going to get it into your heart. Joshua 1 and 8 says when you observe to see yourself doing the word of God, that's how you're going to get it into your believing. Into your believing, right? And then it says, do not let this word escape your mouth. You're going to keep speaking the word that's in your heart. You're going to keep speaking the word that you believe. And it says, and then you shall make your way prosperous. And then you shall see good success. That is what Joshua 1 and 8 says. And that's how you make your own way in this world. You make your own way prosperous. You make your own way successful. And not success the way the world describes it, but good success the way the Word of God promises it. Amen. That is how we speak our way into manifesting God's Word and His promises in our lives. And so what does that have to do with the world? It means that that is how our words reflect the Word of God and not the ways of the world. That's how we separate ourselves from the evil in the world, from the lies of the world, from the attacks from the world, from the negativity of the world, and from the prince of this world, Satan himself. by decreeing, declaring, staking our claim, claiming God's promises, and decreeing and declaring them that they shall be established. That's how we make our way in this world, by manifesting the kingdom of God in this world through our lives. Amen. I'll start all over if I don't stop now. That is the word for today. Thank you, thank you, thank you for joining me in this message. Let's go into this song of worship. We'll come back with partnership and prayer. God bless you. Thank you once again for joining me back for this time of partnership. I invite you to consider the House of His Glory your home congregation. If you would like to be a member of this congregation and you are not, it's super duper easy. Go to the main website, thehouseofhisglory.com. Click on the contact page and there's a link on there that says join the congregation. It's a brief little online form, just some basic information. And if you fill out that form, I will send you by email a new members kit. It's got some good stuff that will bless your life and fill your heart and help you know just exactly all about this congregation that is your home. And if you would like to partner with this message, if you would like God to manifest this message in your life, you can do so by your giving. God says that when you bring your offering, He will pour you out a blessing so great that you cannot, that it cannot be contained. Well, that blessing is His word that He's going to pour out into your life so that you can be poured out into the lives of others. And so, however you give, members, if you would like to bring your tithes at this time, anyone who has a need in your life, if you would like to sow a seed towards that need, you can do so. Click on the giving link above the logo if you're watching us live. If you're on the website or the app, find the three menu bars. There's a giving link there. And however you give, if you have a need and you put a message in there, I'm praying with you. Pray for me. And however you give, it's all coming back to you. Luke 6:38 says, give and it shall be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give unto your bosom. And the measure with which you mete it out, it shall be measured back to you again. That's abundance. That's His best. And no matter what it is, finances, prayer, love, support, encouragement, a kind word, whatever you give, it's all coming back to you. And whatever you give into this congregation, it blesses me, and I know it blesses God too. So thank you so much for your giving. And let's go now into our final closing prayer. Thank you everyone for joining me today. Please just turn your hearts with me towards our Heavenly Father, and let's thank Him for this word and have Him seal it upon our lives. Father, we love you so much. We thank you for this message. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who is the truth, the way, and the life. Thank you for blessing our lives with this word. Thank you for filling our lives with truth and clarity and purpose and direction. Father, thank you for helping us see that there's so much for us in this world that we can achieve, that we can receive through you by faith. Father, thank you that you have abundance for us, that you have prosperity for us, that you have success for us, that you have healing and divine health for us, that you have abundance for us. Thank you, Father God, for every promise of your word, and that all of your promises are yes, that you'll protect our families, that you'll protect our jobs, that you'll protect us with safety, that you'll protect our finances, that you'll teach us how to thrive and walk in your love and your grace and your mercy, and that we'll see that reflected through favor on our lives, favor in our finances, favor in our relationships, favor on our jobs, and just favor in the world, so that through your favor, we will have a witness, a testimony, a word, a praise report that will draw others unto you. Father, thank you for helping us live the kind of lives that will draw the lost and give them a desire to know you as well. That when we prosper in every aspect of our lives, it brings glory to you, because the world sees us and they can see you in our lives. Oh, Father God, we thank you so much for being a good, good God. We thank you, oh, we thank you for all the good that you have brought into our lives through friends, through family, through loved ones, through taking care of us when we could not care for ourselves, through healing, through abundance, and just through your care and your love and your forgiveness. We love you so much. We thank you, we praise you, we glorify you, and we magnify you, praying this prayer in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Fathers, have a wonderful day today. Mothers, I love you too today and every day. And I'll see you next week in our final message for the month of June. Already, it's going so fast. And until then, go in His glory, walk in His power, and receive all the blessings of the kingdom of God. I love you. Bye-bye.